Hello, family and friends and congregation. I pray that all is well with you. Welcome to this broadcast. You'll notice by the title of it that I said, when you get the call, or when we get the call. What am I talking about? You know, we've all received those calls in the middle of the night. I did a little over a month ago when I got the call in the middle of the night that my mother had passed. We've all gotten those calls when maybe a child was suspended from school and we have to come get them or they're sick. I'm not talking about those kinds of calls. I'm talking about the call from God. Have you received the call from God for your life? What has God called you to do in your life? For myself, those of you who have been following me or those of you in a part of our church family, you already know the history. I've been a Christian for over 30 years, and God called me to preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And within the last few years, I added a Christian counselor onto that as I went to school to get that certification and that degree also. And so the call on my life is to preach and to teach and to counsel from the Word of God. And God made it very clear to me that that is what I was to do for the rest of my life. No matter what else came up, no matter what else I may have been thinking about, my plans were put on hold. My plans were actually torn up. Now, I will tell you, when I was a younger man, like probably most of us, I wrote down some life goals that I had for myself. I wrote down things that I wanted to do with my life, a bucket list, if you will. And I put down all these things that I wanted to do. Can I tell you that at this point in time, that bucket list is gone? It's not that I fulfilled everything on it. It's that that list became irrelevant once I was called by God. Well, you know, we read throughout Scripture time and time again of God calling certain people for certain purposes. For instance, we read in Genesis 12 where he calls Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees and he says, I'm going to send you into a land. We see the call of Moses in Exodus when Moses is called upon by God to go back to Egypt and rescue the Israelites and lead them out from under the Egyptian rule. We read of the call of Isaiah. We see all the prophets who were called. Even someone like Amos was called. He was doing something else when God called him. Well, I was doing something else too when God called me. What were you doing or what are you doing? And what we want to examine tonight is, has God called you already? And if he has, what has he called you to do? And I want to show one example. You know, our church family, we do daily Bible readings. We're currently reading through 2 Kings. But I know at some point in the past year, we had looked at the book of Jeremiah, which happens to be one of my favorite books in all of Scripture. And so I want us to look, if you have a Bible with you, I want us to look in Jeremiah chapter 1. I want to read just a few verses. I want you to see what happened with Jeremiah when he was called. Because Jeremiah did not have an easy time of it. If you read through the book of Jeremiah, and I encourage you to do that, it is not, by far, it is not the easiest book in the Bible to understand. It is rather complex. But I do challenge you to try to read the book of Jeremiah, because you will find why he's known as the weeping prophet. Some of the things that he went through. But you know, when you get the call, when you get the call from God, the call, and you know it beyond a shadow of a doubt, everything else in your life stops. Any plans that you had are over when you receive the call from God. So let's see if we're in Jeremiah chapter 1, and I want to read a couple of these verses. Let's start in verse 4. It says, now the word of the Lord came to me, me meaning Jeremiah, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations. That's extraordinary. We don't see that in the Bible very often, if at all, where someone says, before you were even conceived, before you were even in the womb, I knew you. The only one that I'm thinking of right now is John the Baptist. If you remember in Luke, I believe it's Luke chapter 2, when Mary went to visit her cousin Elizabeth. And the Bible says that the baby leaped in Elizabeth's womb. John the Baptist was saved before he was even born. He was another one that was called in the womb here. It says, the word of the Lord came to me, Jeremiah saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Well, with all true believers, God, of course, knows all of us, doesn't he? He knows you and he knows me. But God is talking about something even in an more intimate way. He's saying, I knew you, Jeremiah. I knew exactly what you were going to do because I have appointed you to do that. He says, and before you were even born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations. Can you imagine receiving that kind of call from God? Now, I know what the call felt like when God called me. And I'm sure if you have already received that call in your life, where there's no doubt in your mind what you are supposed to do and what God has called you to do, there's not a doubt in your mind. When you've received the call, there's nowhere else you can turn down God if you want, but he's going to make a rough time of it because he's called you to do something. Remember when he called Jonah and he told Jonah to go to Nineveh and preach to it? What did Jonah do? He ran off. He got in a boat and he sailed the other way. He tried to get away from God. Didn't work, did it? Read the book of Jonah sometime and you'll find that God came and got him and he got swallowed in a whale and God had plenty of time to talk to him. And then Jonah went and did what God said he was going to do. So when you get a call from God, you can try to run from him. You can try to deny him and God may give you a little leeway with that. But eventually you're going to do what God has called you to do. If you are a true believer and if you have a heart to serve God, you will do what he called you to do. Now, some calls are scarier than others. Imagine Jeremiah. Listen to what he's saying here. God is saying, I knew you before you were even formed. I consecrated you and I have appointed you. God selected Jeremiah. He says, I've appointed you a prophet to the nations. That is scary. A prophet to the nations, plural. See, if you were called, let's say, to the mission field, let's say you were going to a mission field and they said, God says, I want you to be a missionary to China, or I want you to go to Russia. And I know missionaries that have been sent out to these various countries that have been sent out through our church and other churches around the world. And they are designated to go to a specific area because they have a heart for those people or a particular culture. But here, Jeremiah is saying, I'm going to send you as a prophet to the nations. Can you imagine what Jeremiah must have felt to hear that from God? But look at his reaction. Verse 6. Here is Jeremiah's initial reaction to the call. He says, then I said, alas, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak because I am a youth. That's his first excuse or his first reasoning with God why he can't do what God called him to do. He cannot speak, he says, and he's still a youth. He's too young. How dare God call him to go and do something when he's young? Do you know it doesn't matter what age we are when God calls us? I was 23 when God called me and started molding me and working me with me towards the call that he eventually had for my life. And here we are at age 57. Yes, I'm 57. And all of these years later, God is still shaping me and molding me. But that initial call that he gave me has never changed. It has intensified. I've moved to different areas, but the call of ministry has always been on me. But look at what Jeremiah says. He says, Lord, no, I don't know how to speak. I'm still a youth. In other words, I don't have the knowledge. Maybe I don't have this persuasion. I'm too young to be doing what you're saying, Lord. You're saying, maybe you could send out someone else. He says, alas, I do not know how to speak. Maybe he's thinking, I'm not trained. Maybe you're thinking the same thing. If God has called you to preach and you're thinking, but wait a minute, I haven't been to seminary. I'm not ordained. I'm not a pastor or a minister. Lord, how are you getting me or wanting me to go out and share with other people? I'm too young. I don't have the knowledge. I'm too youthful. I'm not educated. We make excuses when God lays the call on our life. We very often make excuses. And God is going to get his way because he's God. Now, I want you to see how God works through this issue with him. Verse 7. Now, God has just listened patiently to what Jeremiah said. Jeremiah says, I don't know how to speak because I'm a youth. I'm young. I'm uneducated. I don't have a degree. Verse 7. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth. Because everywhere I send you, you shall go. And all that I command you, you shall speak. Does it sound like God is backing down a little bit? Does it sound like he's giving up on Jeremiah and say, you know, you aren't the one after all. I'll just select someone else. No, no, no. Jeremiah has been selected. He got the call from God, and God has to work with him the same way he had to work with me. And very likely he's working with you in your call and in your walk with him. God is saying, look, don't say you're a youth. God already knew what Jeremiah was and where he was skill-wise. He's saying, don't say I am a youth. You can't use that as an excuse. You can't say just because you're young or you're inexperienced that God can't use you. God says, everywhere I'm going to send you, you shall go. Do you notice the command there, Jeremiah? Wherever I say for you to go, you're going to go. There's not an option there. He's not saying to Jeremiah, if you want to go, if you decide to go. He's saying, wherever I send you, you're going. And secondary, he says, and all that I command you, you shall speak. Well, that takes care of everything, doesn't it? Jeremiah doesn't have to worry about where he's going. God's going to show him. And Jeremiah doesn't have to be concerned what he's going to say, because God is going to command him what to say, and he will say it. And that's why I encourage you to read through Jeremiah, and you can see what he said over and over again as he's talking to the nations, he's talking to the people, and the situations that he gets himself in. It all starts with the call. When you get the call, you have two options. One, you obey God, and two, you try to run from God and not do what he tells you. Option number two is not going to work out very well, because God will have his way and his will always be done. And I got news for you. If he has called you to do something and you're resisting, may I suggest this to you, that you surrender yourself to God. Surrender yourself to the call that he has put on your life. It may not be what you expect it to be in your life, but God knows what he's doing. As we read throughout the scripture and we see how he selected certain people for certain things, and each one of them did what God told them to do. Some with a little more complaining than others, some with some excuses in the front end. Remember, even Moses said, I can't even speak right. And what did God say? I'll send your brother Aaron with you. God always makes a provision. So where is he calling you today? Where is he calling you tonight? Maybe he's already called you. Maybe he already has you on a path. Maybe he already has you ministering to someone, or you're already in the mission field, or he's put you in a prayer closet. Wherever God has called you, if you have received the call, then you know it beyond a shadow of doubt that it is the Holy Spirit that has called you into service for God. And all of us who are true believers have an obligation to serve God in some way. Not everyone gets to be a pastor or gets put in the pulpit or preaches. Not everyone goes into music ministry. Not everyone gets called into nursing home or out to the mission fields or to help the homeless or work in soup kitchens or become a medical professional so that you can start healing people. God calls all kinds of people to all kinds of things for his glory, for his glory. And so we look at Jeremiah, and he's saying, Jeremiah, wherever I send you, you're going to go. And whatever I tell you to say, you're going to say. Let's continue. Now, God continues in verse 8, assuring Jeremiah that everything's going to be okay. He says, do not be afraid of them. Who's them? All the people he's going to encounter, the nations, all those people, because Jeremiah is going to have a very challenging and rough call, because people are not going to listen to him. They're going to turn him down. They're not going to be interested in what he's saying. And God is saying, don't even be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Deliver you. I'm going to protect you. Jeremiah, if I send you out, then I'm going to protect you. If I send you out, then I will be watching over you. I will show you where to go. I will tell you what to say. And I will deliver you. I will protect you from whatever happens out there, because Jeremiah was given a very specific call. And again, if you have not read through the book of Jeremiah, he runs into quite a few situations where he's not the most well-liked, but he sees even visions of Jerusalem being totally destroyed. Read the book of Lamentations, which he wrote also. When you read Lamentations, A lamentation, to lament, is to be sad over, to be broken heart over. Lamentations is one of the saddest books in all the scripture. But Jeremiah had to go through that. Do you think, and you know, we don't want to speculate, if Jeremiah had his choice, if he had his choice, do you think he wouldn't have gone? Or do you think he would have gone anyway? Do you think you have a choice if God has called you? I had different plans for my life. I wanted to do other things. Now, God, in his mercy, had allowed me to do a few things that I truly wanted to do. And I'm not disputing that. I'm not saying anything bad about God at all. But I want to share this with you. I am glad that he called me to do his bidding, to do his work. I'm glad that I work for Jesus Christ. I am glad of where he put me. My trip since I started ministry has started three states. This is my third state, as I'm currently in the state of Illinois. Third state, many, many churches, many sermons later, hundreds of songs written later in music ministry over the years, many people, couples married, all the different things that God has called me to do. But the initial call has never changed, and that is preach and teach, and in any added counseling in. What has God called you to do? What is it you're doing today for the kingdom of God? You know, another thing that I want to look at, and I've looked at this passage before. I'm sure you've heard it preached a lot. Do you remember when Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee in Matthew? And what did he do with the initial first set of disciples? Remember, he came along and he saw them and they were fishing. And he said to them, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." I'm going to turn to that in a minute, because it's such an important thing, a nice companion to what we're looking at here. In Matthew 4, he calls the first disciples. It says here, as Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said unto them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Now watch this. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. Immediately. It says immediately, not two Sundays later, not when they hauled in their fish, not when they decided to go back and tell their families what was going on. Their response was immediately. They had received the call. They got the call from Jesus. Jesus wasn't done yet. He had a couple more disciples to call. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and he called them. Look what happens. Immediately, they left the boat and their father and followed him. God brings it out even more. They didn't just leave their livelihood behind. They didn't just leave their money-making business behind. They left their father behind. Because God elsewhere says that we must serve God even before our own families. We have to love Jesus more than anything or anyone else. That's all part of the call. And when you receive the call on your life, you are serving Jesus Christ. You are serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are serving Almighty God. He calls you and he calls me to do something for him in our life. So again, what has he called you to do? And if he has called you, what was your response to it? Did you just say, "Yay, Lord"? Or did you resist? Or did you pull back? Or did you actually say, "You know, I don't really think I heard from God, so I'm going to pull back a little bit. I don't think I really heard from him. I don't think that's what God was saying." Or are you actually doing what God has called you to do? Whatever it is. Where are you at today? Are you like Jeremiah, making excuses, saying, "Lord, I'm just a youth. I don't know anything." Or are you like these disciples that came along and immediately dropped everything to follow Jesus? Another wonderful example is in Genesis 12. And I mentioned it earlier. It's when Abraham got his call. Talk about the call. In Genesis 12, says this in verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you." Wow. Imagine that call. Imagine somebody saying to you, you're going to leave your country and you're going to leave your family. You're even going to leave your father's house where you live. You're going to leave. And you know where you're going? To a country that I will show you. Imagine if that call came to you today, that God called you tonight. Maybe he woke you up in the middle of the night. Maybe during your prayer time or your Bible time, you get this conviction and you get the call from God to say, I'm going to send you somewhere. What's your reaction? Look what he says to Abraham. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. That was a specific promise to Abram. But look what he does in verse 4. See if there's any hesitation here. So Abram went forth as the Lord had spoken to him. Wow. Abram packed up his wife, Sarai, and all of their livestock and all of their workers. He took Lot with him, and he set out on the journey. Did he turn to look behind? No, he left. He got the call. He got the call from God. We see it over and over again. God can use anyone, anywhere, for anything. And please don't think ever that you're not qualified, that you're not smart enough, that you don't have enough education, that you don't have enough letters after your name, that you're not ordained, that you don't look the part. You don't make that determination, and neither do I. God determines who he calls and what he does. The point of this broadcast is when you get the call, you need to make sure that your response is correct. God, where are you sending me? I'm going to give you one more example. You probably know where I'm going. It's Isaiah, our old friend Isaiah. Remember when he got the call? Isaiah got the call in chapter 6 of his book. He says in verse 8, God said this, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, Lord, send me." That was Isaiah's call. God is asking, who am I going to send? Who's going to go for us? Who's going to step up? Who is going to do what I've called him to do? And what does Isaiah say? Here I am, Lord, send me. And he went off on his journey too, and he went off on his call. And as you read through Isaiah, you'll see the situations that he found himself in also. So I wanted to just spend a few minutes here talking about the call. When you receive the call in your life, it is the most important call you will ever get in your life. Even if someone called you up and said, you want $1 billion, not important. Even if someone called you up and said you had all the riches of the world, you had anything you could ever want, that's not the call you want. What you want is the call. You want the call from God. And if you are seeking God, earnestly seeking, if you don't know what your call is yet, if you're not sure, God will relay that to you at any time when he is ready. But you have to be ready for the call also. Not everyone is ready. Sometimes it comes up as a great big surprise, like suddenly with Jeremiah, hey, don't be afraid, go on. In another case, God asks questions like he did with Isaiah and said, who's going to go for us? And Isaiah steps up to the plate because he was convicted. And other times, Jesus comes along and he gets his disciples and he says, come on, follow me. And immediately they go ahead and follow him. The call can come in different ways and for different reasons. But I promise you, you will know when it's the call. Your life will never be the same. It will change the entire life and the trajectory of your life. And let me rejoice with you, if you already have received the call in your life and you are already doing something and serving the Lord, I pray that it is fruitful, it is fulfilling, and it is the joy of a life to serve the Lord. If you're not sure of your call just yet, keep seeking the Lord and keep praying, because God has something to do. Every one of us has something to do for his kingdom. Every one of us. So let me just encourage you. When you get the call, run with it. You will never regret answering the call of God, ever. I pray that this study or this message has helped you. If it has, please feel free to share it. God says in Isaiah 55, 11, he said, my word will not return void. He said, it's going to reach everybody I intended to reach. Did it reach you tonight? Did it speak to you tonight? Did it convict you tonight? If it did, please feel free to share it with someone else who would need to hear it. And also, church family, oh, we say it all the time. We call ourselves Bereans. We're a church of Bereans. That's because in Acts 17:11, the Bible says that the Bereans were more noble than other people. Doesn't mean that they were smarter. They weren't richer. They didn't have more knowledge, but they were more noble. Why? Because they searched the scriptures daily to make sure that what they were hearing was true. I encourage you. I ask you with this message, with anyone that you hear, television, radio, internet, any church you belong to, any Bible study you read, you see, you hear, check that out against the Bible. Make sure that you are searching the scriptures. Go over the references and go over the passages that have been preached or have been taught on to make sure that what you're hearing is true. I mean, let's face it. There's a lot of things that are being preached, that are being taught, that simply are not true. They're just not true. They can't be proved by scripture. A lot of them are from twisted interpretations. People just putting their own spin on it. And they wind up with a theology that has nothing to do with the Bible. Be careful. Be a Berean. Check it out for yourself. The Holy Spirit will give you wisdom. The more you read the Bible, the more you study it, the more you get to know God. Last thing, we have a website, livinginharmonyministries.org, livinginharmonyministries.org. If you haven't seen our website yet, we're in the process. We're going to be putting some new videos up soon. We already have some content on there. But we have a ministry that has an array of services that we help individuals and also church bodies. And we are available for preaching, for teaching, for counseling, for helping you construct your church body and so on. If you want to stop by and see what we have to offer, I invite you to stop by at livinginharmonyministries.org, livinginharmonyministries.org. See what we can do to help you in your walk with Christ. If it's not a help to you, it's okay. If you just want to pass that website on to someone else, that would be wonderful. If it's not for you, it's perfectly okay. Would you also prayerfully consider how you might be able to support this ministry? This is a walk of faith for us. There's no big money behind it. There's no corporations behind it. It's just us just kind of trudging along. And if you feel led by God to support us, there is a place on the website where you can make a donation or give an offering. Most of all, what we do is we covet your prayers. That's what we need. We need your support spiritually so that we can keep going, because Satan is attacking this ministry. I'm just going to be honest with you. And church family, you already know what I'm talking about. But those who may be tuning in who are not familiar with this ministry, Satan is attacking this ministry in every way. He's attacking it emotionally, mentally, physical issues, spiritually, and also financially. He's trying to shut the ministry down. He is trying to turn this ministry off so that we will stop sharing the gospel, we will stop counseling people, we will stop teaching and standing on the front lines for Christ. And we say, devil, we rebuke you in the name of Jesus. You are not welcome here. You're not welcome in this ministry. You're not welcome on this broadcast. But we are under attack. And so would you please pray and keep us in your prayers, that the devil would just finally get tired of dealing with us, those of us who are standing on the front lines of Christ, for Christ, and then he would go off and leave us be. The Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. We are resisting the devil, but he is persistent. He doesn't give up easy. And so I want to thank you for spending this time with us tonight here, and I pray that you have a better understanding of what the call is when it comes to your life. Thanks for being with me. God bless you.